out together. Here's a temple. Here's a temple full of light, where my troubles, they run and hide. A tabernacle where you're at all, and I'm at home in the house of the Lord. A house of repentance, a place of redemption, an altar of worship where your praise is unending. A fortress I run to where I need nothing more. In the house of the Lord, in the house of the Lord. My foundation, cornerstone,
of the Lord, that we get to worship Him in spirit and truth. And sometimes it's great to begin a service by having Scripture just wash over us. And that's what we're going to do right now. We're going to continue to engage in worship by reading His Word, that we can engage our hearts and our minds. So let's look at this psalm together. Psalm 96, it's verses 1 through 11. We're going to read it out loud together. All right? Are you ready? Get your eyes out there. Sing a new song to the Lord. Let the whole earth sing to the Lord. Sing to the Lord, bless his name. Proclaim his salvation from day to day. Declare his glory among the nations, his wondrous works among all peoples. For the Lord is great and highly to be praised. He is feared above all gods. For all the gods of the peoples are worthless idols, but the Lord made the heavens. Splendor and majesty are before him. Strength and beauty are in his sanctuary. Ready? Ascribe to the Lord, you families of the peoples. Ascribe to the Lord glory and strength. Ascribe to the Lord the glory of his name. Bring an offering and enter his courts. Worship the Lord in splendor of his holiness. Let the whole earth tremble before him. Say among the nations, the Lord reigns. The world is firmly established. It cannot be shaken. He judges the peoples fairly. Let the heavens be glad and the earth rejoice. Let the sea and all that is in it, fill it resounds. Let's pray. God, thanks for being with us today, that we know your presence of comfort, your presence of peace, your presence of strength. We've come in here today to worship you because of your majesty. So Lord, hear our hearts, and may you connect our hearts and our minds as we worship you. In Jesus' holy name we pray, amen. Let's continue worshiping the Lord.
All right, let's sing together.
Now to him be the glory, who is able to do more than we could ask or imagine. And amen, amen, to him be the glory. Let his people shout his victory through all generations. And amen, amen, to him be the glory, who is able to do more than we could. By the grace of God, amen, I have been raised to a future without end. I set my eyes on a true and loyal friend, the one whose life I'm hidden in. We'll sing his name, Jesus.
Jesus.
You won't forsake us.
Spirit in this room. I love those words that he's working and he's moving in our midst. And, you know, I was thinking about how he works in our hearts. And, but I was also so struck this morning as we're seeing that, just how he is. He's working in this church. And he's working in this body here, this house. I'm so grateful that, you know, this is God's church, right? And unless the Lord builds the house, the builders, we just build in vain. And so we want this to be God's church. We want to do things his way. And I'm just so thankful that he's been working in our midst. He's been working in this room. But he does that as he works in our hearts and our lives. And I just want to invite us to this place of repentance, actually, this morning. I just haven't been able to shake just this call to return back to the Lord, to come back to him. And I don't know, you know, God knows your heart. He knows what you are struggling with. But the first song we sang, it said, this is a house of repentance. And then it's a house of redemption. But we can't recognize our need. We can't sit in the wonder and the grace of Jesus if we don't recognize our need for him. Man, I just think we just do too much of this Christian life thinking that it's Jesus and something. Jesus and my own efforts. Jesus and all the checking of the boxes. Jesus and it's okay, I'll figure it out. I got this one. But that's not the beauty of the gospel. It's Jesus and Jesus. And so I just want right now just for you to take a minute and just ask the Holy Spirit to search your hearts. Where are the ways that you've been white-knuckling your faith, your finances, your marriage, parenthood, your own plans? Just confess to the Lord. The sins in your heart that you just keep tucking aside, tucking away. But let today be the day of confession, because when we confess, we have redemption and we have freedom. So right now, just take a moment. Just sing this out loud one more time. Sing Waymaker. It's your voice. praise and adoration. We thank you for the work that you've already begun this morning in our hearts. And what else can we say but, God, you're holy. We love you. We're in awe of you and who you are. God over all of heaven and earth, and Savior of our hearts. We love you. We honor you. We give you glory this morning. And it is in the matchless name of Jesus that we all say together, amen. 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 It's a beautiful time of worship, you guys, together. Go ahead and grab a seat.
Well, I love the way our hearts have been engaged in worship. I hope your heart is full. My name is John. I serve as one of the pastors here, and glad to see you here today. But if this is your first time, or maybe we haven't had a chance to meet, can we do that after the service today? I'm going to be hanging out in the lobby and would love to have a conversation with you. Maybe you've got some questions about Harvest. Maybe you're looking to get connected at Harvest. Just whatever I can do to serve you, that would be great. And so if it's even a cup of coffee, just to get to know you a little bit and see what it is that might be your next step in your walk with Jesus. And if you're a regular part of Harvest, you know that we have an app. And on that app, there's a lot of different things that are available to you. If you haven't downloaded that, please do that. There's a QR code in front of you if you haven't downloaded it. And you can check in today. But more than that, I would love for you to take a moment to say, where do I need prayer? And submit a prayer request. And our staff would be loving to pray with you for that. Maybe this week as you hear God's word, and you're like, I want to follow God's word every day. There's a message application guide right on that app for you to open it up and look at some questions and take God's word in front of you and just, Lord, meet me today. So that's a couple ways you can use that app, and I hope that you will just take a moment and introduce yourself to that. Well, church family, we are thrilled that we have different classes that are offered throughout the year, but we've got one class called Grace Marriage that it's an entire year, and it's for couples that have been married, and it doesn't matter if you've been married a week or you've been married 30 years. It's an opportunity for you to grow in your relationship with your spouse, to grow that union tighter, to grow that union stronger, to understand what God has for you in the days ahead. And so it's a class that goes for a year. You meet four times during that year on a Saturday for a longer period of time to spend together with other couples. But there's a lot more information about this class called Grace Marriage online at harvestbible.org. I hope you'll take a minute to look at that and see if that would be an encouragement to you and to your family. Well, we've been doing this all day. Psalm 100 says, enter his gates with thanksgiving and enter his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and bless his name. That's what we've been doing. But you know, that verse also ties in our giving. And so each week in the service, we take time to think about, Lord, you've been so gracious and generous to us. You've been the God who provides, and we want to give with that same spirit of thankfulness. So whether you give today or you give as you walk out the doors, there's little blue boxes, or you give online, there's several ways that are listed on the screen. Would you let that verse just penetrate your heart in the moment that you give and say, thank you, God. You're the giver of all good gifts. You know, we're not the only church that has a mindset that way. There's a church right down the road called The Orchard, and they are worshiping the Lord today, actually right now. And I would love for us to be praying for Pastor Colin Smith as he opens God's word. I was talking to Brad, who's their campus pastor, this last week, and he said, hey, if you could pray for us in a couple specific ways. Our ministry year is launching in 2 weeks, and if you would just pray that our people would grow in their faith and their hope and their love and the way that they live. What a great, great testimony to grow in our outreach in our community. And so I'm just gonna pray over them and pray for us, and let's do that together. God, we have come to your presence today, and we've had the time to repent and to reflect and to remember and to restore our hearts in worship. Lord, I'm so thankful that you receive us just as we are. Thank you for the chance that we have to trust you in many different ways, and some ways that we trust you are in relation to our finances, and that you will care for us as your children, you'll care for us as a church, your church, Lord. Would you use these monies that come in today and this week to further your kingdom? Would you help us to be wise in the way that they are directed? And so, Father, you ask us just to have a heart of thankfulness, a heart of gratefulness, and we want to do that now. We pray for Pastor Colin as he preaches God's word today, that you would just meet him right where he is and that your word would come through with boldness and clarity, and for the people to respond with a greater faith, hope, and love. We love you. Do your work in our hearts today as we open your word. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, before we open God's word, why don't you stand to your feet real quick and greet someone by you that you don't know and just say, hi, my name is, and let them know you're grateful you're here today.
Usually, I start my sermons by saying, if you have a Bible, you should open it to this particular page. I'm not going to talk at all about the Bible today. I'm kidding. Atta girl. See, you know. We're going to be all over the scriptures. And so it might be just helpful if you follow along with me here. We're going to start in Book of Esther, chapter 4, verse 13 here in the next couple minutes, but then from there we're going to be all over the place. The reason for that is because I want to talk to you today, especially about where we see harvest going in the days ahead and what kinds of things are we doing. I titled the sermon, What Are We Even Doing Here? Have you guys ever heard the saying, a camel is a horse built by a committee? No? It's kind of true though, right? I mean, it's not really true. It's not like God was in heaven and asking people their opinions. A camel is a camel. But that's a business saying that people use often. If you're in a boardroom and an idea comes up and it's not well thought through or focused, people will be like, that's a camel. And you know what it's like to be in a committee. It's part of the fallen world is to be in committees. And you sit in this committee in a room full of people, and usually people don't want to say anything really straightforward to the other people in the committee because, you know, you're friends or maybe you don't know them that well or whatever. And the idea comes up and you're like, okay, we're going to try to put on this particular party for the party planning committee, right? So we're going to put the party. Well, one person has an opinion about like, oh, we should have a food truck. And everybody else like, oh, that's fine. And somebody else says, we should have 1,000 balloons. And the other person says that we should actually have a carnival with a big Ferris wheel and blah, blah, blah. And they go around and around and they have all the ideas. They put them on the board. And usually what ends up happening is that nobody's got the, you know, some people think some of those ideas are really bad, but they don't want to say it because, you know, they're your friends or whatever. This is the nature of a committee. You don't want to put anybody down. There's usually not any strong-handed leader of the committee who says no, or, you know, you report that person to the boss. So in the end, what do you end up with? Some monstrosity that happens on a, you know, Thursday afternoon, and you're like, what in the world is this thing? And the answer is it's a camel. It's a camel. You compare that kind of approach to the approach that a sculptor takes. See, a sculptor is really, really focused on exactly what they want the sculpture to look like. So you're going to sculpt a horse. When the sculptor gets in there and he starts cutting, he'll cut away everything that doesn't look like a horse, like his hammer and chisel, and he'll cut everything away that doesn't look like a horse. And so when the hump is there, the camel hump, he'll be like, this is not a horse. And he gets rid of it. One approach is just kind of amalgamation of all the different things, and we can do all of these things because all of them are just fun and awesome. And the other is, no, there's a certain thing we're after. And it's going to require us to be focused about that thing, to define it clearly. to picture it clearly. So what are we trying to make? What's our sculpture here at Harvest? What do we want to do? Yeah, so the question is, what are we supposed to be doing here? The church, historically, has always had this line that says that Harvest exists to make disciples in obedience to the Great Commission. That's absolutely true. It's absolutely true. Every church worth its salt is going to say that we're here to make a disciple, a genuine follower of Jesus Christ. The challenge is that most churches don't define that. Most Christians don't define that. We know the word is used in Scripture, disciple, but we don't ever stop and think, okay, what does it really look like to follow Jesus? What marks or character traits do disciples have? And more importantly, if we as a church are going to make disciples, what kind of disciples are we making? Well, we spent a lot of time over the last year and a bit thinking through that question at Harvest. What are the marks of the kinds of disciples that we want to make? And so we came up with four phrases that describe the disciples that we want to make. Here they are. We think that the Harvest kind of disciple, the person that we want to be on mission and the person that we want to multiply throughout Chicagoland and perhaps around the world, is one uniquely planted, deeply rooted, carefully pruned, and persistently fruitful. Now, I want to explain each one of those. This is going to be a Bible study. Each one comes from a particular passage of Scripture, or each one comes from an understanding of Scripture as a whole and what it's trying to say about what a disciple is supposed to be and do, okay? So let's start with the first one, uniquely planted. The disciple is uniquely planted. One of the greatest stories in the entire world, quite honestly, is Esther. The book in the Hebrew Scriptures, the book of Esther. A lot of people, if you're new to the faith, you probably never heard it. Other people might have heard the story of Esther when they were little and they were reading some stuff, you know, within their little Bible storybook or whatever, but never got into the entire story. It is a remarkable story. So here, let me give it to you. There's a king. His name is King Ahasuerus, and he is married to a woman named Vashti. King Ahasuerus, Queen Vashti, they decide that they want to have a big party. Probably the king decides it, and the queen's like, yeah, okay. Now, the parties in those days were not the kinds of parties that you would have, like, after church today. You know, like, you go to someone's house or whatever, and you sit there from 1 o'clock, and then when 3:30 rolls around, the people who are hosting, you're thinking, when you could go now. You know, please leave. They're not short like that. The parties that they would throw then would last days. In this case, weeks. So 1 week into the party, you got to be thinking that one of the things that they did a lot, of course, in the parties was drink. In this particular party, they had separated the men and the women. So Queen Vashti had all of her girlfriends, and King Ahasuerus had all the dudes together. And all the dudes are drinking and partying 7 straight days. And finally, on the 7th day, when I'm quite sure very few of them were sober, the king says, maybe prompted by someone else, maybe just in his own head, he's trying to impress his friends. He says, dudes, have you seen my wife? She is so hot. You should have a look at her. And the other drunk guys are like, we would like that a lot. So he sends word over to the queen, who's having her own little party. And the word is, hey, can you put a little something, something on and bring it over so you can do a little twirl in front of my drunk friends so they can ogle you and think impure thoughts? And Queen Vashti says, no. I don't think I will. Which, of course, is against the law. You're not supposed to say no to the king. So instead of them bringing the servant coming and bringing Vashti back, he just comes alone and he's like, yeah, she doesn't want to do it. And the king's like, what? What do you mean she doesn't want to do it? She doesn't have a choice. How dare she? And all the friends are like, yes, exactly. How dare she? Not only is she doing this, she's doing it in public before all of us. Can you imagine when this news filters out into the society and every man is asking his wife to do something, and she's like, no. How bad is this gonna be? We gotta put a stop to it right now. And the king says, that's right. Kick her out. He does. Vashti's gone. Kick to the curb. Well, we need a new queen. How are we gonna do it? And the drunk king says, we should have a beauty pageant. We should get all the women from all of the land, all the best looking ones. And what they'll do is they'll come in and we will give them a year of a beauty treatment. Guys, even I would look good after a year of beauty treatment. You know what I mean? Like, this is how I look with like 5 minutes. Can you imagine a year? It'd be amazing. Year of beauty treatment. And then it all built up to one night. You got one night to try things out with the king. If he liked you, you could stick around and be his wife. That's the win. If not, you get to go into his harem, which is just a big group of women that he gets to play around with when he wants to. So all the women from all the land, they get gathered up together and they go into this grand beauty pageant. One of them is a woman named Esther. Esther is a Jewish woman. That's not something that you would tell everybody in those days, by the way. It's not like, oh, I'm Jewish. Don't you love my religion? Let's endorse and embrace all the different viewpoints. Actually, no. You would hide some of that. There were lots of Jewish people around. It was expected that you would worship the kings and those sorts of things and the other gods of the day. And so the Jews didn't always like say, yeah, we don't worship all those gods. You know, just keep your head down and keep going. So anyway, she's a Jewish woman. She has a father who's actually her uncle. His name's Mordecai. So he brought her up. They come and get her. They take her off to the kingdom. She does her year of beauty treatment. The king goes through all the other women in the land. And then on the given night, Esther goes into him. And like the days after, he's so entranced with Esther. He's like, we have found our queen. So they have a big party, right? Slay, queen. And there she is, Queen Esther. Meanwhile, there's this guy. His name is Haman. And he's a political animal, this guy. He's climbing up through the ranks of the kingdom. And he gets really close to the top. I mean, he becomes a real advisor to the king. And when he gets to the point where he's a real advisor to the king, this guy's really pompous, loves people to treat him with all sorts of regard. And so he asks the king one day, hey, could you make a law that wherever I go, people will bow down to me? This is the law I put in place here at Harvest for the staff just this week. So can you make a law that everyone will bow down to me? And the king's like, man, you're a good dude. And yeah, sure. So he makes this law. And so Haman's going out and he's walking around and he's bowing, bow, 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 bow. Everyone's bowing except for Mordecai. Remember Esther's uncle / father? He's a Jewish man and he's like, I'm not gonna bow down to you. I bow down to Yahweh, that's it. And he's the only one who won't bow down. And so Haman's so mad. Keeps telling him, you better bow down. You'd be in trouble. Mordecai's like, bring it. I don't care. Doesn't matter. I'm not doing it. So finally, Haman realizes that Mordecai is a Jewish man. And he says, wait a minute. He's not the only Jewish guy. There's all sorts of these Jewish people who aren't willing to bow down to me or to anyone else, even the king. They're not willing to bow down because of their faith in God, in Yahweh. And there's so many of them among us. What if they all gather together? They could form an army and destroy all of us, right? So he goes to the king and he says, hey, king, you need to make a law because there's these people who are hiding among us and they're going to probably gather together one day. There's these Jewish people. They're going to form an army. We need to kill them off before anything like that happens. And the king's like, whoo. Yeah, that is a really good idea, national security stuff. And so he does. Haman is actually kind of the prototypical Hitler. And he gets a decree, an irreversible decree, and he walks out of the throne room with it, and he walks down and he finds Mordecai, and he goes, ha-ha, see what I've got? You're a dead man. Mordecai sees the decree and he realizes, oh my goodness, all of us are going to die. What in the world are we going to do? All the Jewish people are going to die. There's nothing we can do. There's no one who can. Wait a minute. Esther. Like she's Jewish. She's in the kingdom. In fact, she has more access to the king than anyone else. He loves her, adores her, chose her over all the others. What if Esther went in and told the king that what Haman was planning was wicked? Yes, we'll do that. Mordecai sends word to Esther. Esther, of course, replies and says, listen, you don't understand. If I go into the king uninvited, I'm dead. He's shown a propensity to get rid of the last queens. So, like, he'll just get rid of me. Mordecai says, no, you have to do it. You have to do it. This is our only chance. Mordecai told them to reply to Esther, them being the messengers. Don't think to yourself, Esther, that in the king's palace you'll escape any more than all the other Jews. Like, they're going to find out you're Jewish. For if you keep silent at this time, relief and deliverance will rise for the Jews from another place. God's not going to leave us out. He's promised things to us. He's going to deliver us, okay? But you and your father's house, they're going to perish. And who knows, Esther, who knows whether you've not come to the kingdom for such a time as this? Esther, think through how you ended up getting there. I mean, what kind of kingdom has the queen kicked out because she's not going to do a little sexy twirl for the king? I mean, that just doesn't happen. And then what kingdom does a beauty pageant? And what? How in the world did you get chosen out of all these people? Don't you see? You're uniquely planted for this one moment. And Esther told them to reply to Mordecai. Okay. Go gather all the Jews to be found in Susa and hold a fast. Don't eat or drink for 3 days, night or day. I and my young women will also fast as you do. And then I will go to the king, though it's against the law. And if I perish, I perish. Mordecai, I see that God, that somehow I've been placed here. Do you know the name of God is not in this book? Like if I came to you right now and I said, what's the book of Esther about? You'd probably be like, well, it's about Esther and Mordecai and Haman and Ahasuerus. What's the book of Esther about? The answer is the book of Esther is about God. Yeah, but his name's not in there. Yes, but his fingerprints are everywhere. He has woven the tapestry of all these people's lives in just such a way that they're in the unique spot that they need to be in with the unique giftings and courage and abilities that he wanted just then. You could read your entire Bible and you will find that this is actually the way it works over and over again. You ever thought about Moses? I mean, Moses is a guy who's been, you know, he grew up in Pharaoh's household. Runs away because he kills an Egyptian who is beating up one of the Hebrews. He spends 40 years in the desert. God comes to him, burning bush. Come on, man, we're going to go back in. He ends up going back to Pharaoh, who was probably the guy he knew growing up. And then the people of Israel get freed, and then they sin going into the promised land, and then they're in the desert for 40 years. Is that weird to you at all? That the dude who is in the desert for 40 years now is in the desert for 40 years. It's almost like God planned it. Joseph gets sold by his brothers and he goes winding tail with all these people wronging him, Potiphar's wife, and he goes into the dungeon and the bakers. I mean, nobody wants to help Joseph. Eventually, of course, he ends up being second in command of all of Egypt at just the right time to save the people of Israel from the famine. It's almost like all the things that happened to this guy were divinely designed. See, you and I, we listen to stuff about these characters and we're like, yeah, man, I can see that. You can see it. The Bible's filled with stories about the providence of God working people's lives out. But listen, what was true of Esther, what is true of Moses, what was true of Joseph, is also true of you and me. There's not a single person. God's sovereignty extends to every single person in the room. There is not a single person who's listening to me right now who's not uniquely planted where God wants them to be. With just the gifts that you have, with just the wiring that you have, with just. For just such a time as this. Have you guys ever stopped and thought, though, just how, like if you were gonna do the job, you know, like what's your life about? Well, life's about me. Okay, I'm gonna argue that your life is about God. That he's actually the main character in your life, and he's been weaving your life together in particular ways. Just think about all the things that you are not personally responsible for that God actually made happen in your life. Do you guys ever take those personality inventories before? Yeah? You know what I'm talking about? Most of you are not nodding, so are you asleep? So personality inventory, so there's the Myers-Briggs, and there's the strength finders. The one that I'm most accustomed to is the DISC profile. I like it because it's simple. So if you go and you want to get a job or you're going to be working together with a team, a lot of times they'll give you like, hey, take this 15-minute test. They'll ask you a bunch of questions. And then you'll come out with a ranking on each one of these. Each one of these, you will have a certain percentage. Now, if you are a high D, meaning that you get lots and lots of points for the D, that usually means that you're a really strong-minded leader type person. Let's go and take it. Take that hill. If you're an I, that means you love to paint and to dance. You're a very creative type person. The S's are people who high S's tend to be people who are really, they don't want to hurt a fly. They just want to be in the party and enjoy each other's company and let's just sit down and hug our coffee and talk to each other just forever. Just really focused on the people. And the C's love spreadsheets. They're the people who are keeping track of all. I have a list, I made the list, and now I have to tick the boxes in the list in order to feel good. Now, here's the thing. If you take these inventories, one of the things that you learn really quickly is that there is no right or wrong with this sort of thing. There's no like, hey, you know what? If you were a real Christian, you'd be a high D. No, it's just about how God wires different people. And usually what's funny about it is that you can usually describe why it is that you don't get along with somebody else in your company or in your workplace almost entirely based upon the wiring you have. Yet you think they hate you and they think you hate them, and it's only because you misunderstand each other. Because the person who is a high D, right, is like, come on, let's go take the land. And the S is like, but people will get hurt. And the D is like, I don't care about people, I care about the hill. We're taking that hill. Collateral damage. What in the world are you talking about? Let me just go and hug them. Meanwhile, you got the eyes who are just so happy about all the things we can write poems. We should write poetry today. Can you imagine the poetry that we can write to describe this fantastic moment? And the C's are over like, I don't even know what poetry is. I have a list and it needs to be ticked off. The C's think they're helping everybody by having their list. The I thinks they're helping everyone by being just excited and creative. The S's are like, well, I help everyone because I'm a good person and I love everybody. And the D's are like, yeah, I'm trying to help this thing get off the ground. But here's the crazy thing. We all have a wiring. Do you remember when you were in the womb and God came to you and asked you, which one do you want to be here? Do you remember that meeting? You didn't have that meeting? Right, nobody did, because the way you're wired is God's business. The gifts that you have spiritually, as a spiritual gift, a teacher, a leader, whatever, those gifts were given to you by God. He decided what you should have. Your entire history is yours because God made it so. There were highs and there were lows. There were great, great successes and horrible failures. And each one of those things is woven together to form a tapestry of who you are right now. Genuine disciples of Jesus Christ see God's hand everywhere. They recognize that I have been uniquely planted by God, for God, in just such a time as this. Uniquely planted. Oh, disciples, we want a disciple to know, you know, how God's gifted them and made them, how he's been working in their life so that they can figure out what it is that he's got for them. Second, they need to be deeply rooted. One of the passages of scripture that you will become accustomed to if you spend any time with me is the parable of the sower. Many of you know, I talk about it quite a lot because I think it describes an awful lot of what it looks like to follow Jesus and the pitfalls and dangers that are in our way as we continue to follow Jesus till we die happy in him, okay? So here's the way it goes in Luke chapter 8, verse 4. When a great crowd was gathering and people from town after town came to him, he said in a parable. So a sower goes out to sow his seed. Very common thing. Sowers had these bags of seed, and they would walk in the middle of their farm on a path that was dedicated for people walking, because the only way you could usually get from one spot to another was through the farms, right? They're like the back roads of the ancient world. So you were kind of obliged to make a pathway for people to walk in your farm. You don't want them walking on all your crops, so you make a path. So he's walking down the middle, and he's on his path, and he's throwing the seed. A sower went out to sow his seed, and as he sowed, some fell along the path, and it was trampled underfoot. Of course, not just by him, but by everybody. It's like the bypass. Everyone's walking and crushing the seed, and the birds of the air devoured it. Some fell on the rock. That means that it had really shallow soil. Underneath there's a layer of bedrock, and the roots will go down, but they'll just go sideways eventually, right? Because they can't penetrate the rock. Some fell on the rock, and as it grew up, it withered away because it had no moisture. Yeah, it couldn't get deep down into where the moisture was. Some fell among thorns. This is weeds. And the thorns grew up with it and choked it. And everyone who's ever owned a garden knows this, right? Hey, my flowers aren't there, but all the weeds are there. Right, weeds always win. Some fell in good soil and grew and yielded 100-fold. That is a huge yield. 100-fold. So as he said these things, he called out, "He who has ears to hear, let him hear." Now the disciples at this point are like, you know what? Why are you telling stories all the time? Because we're not getting it, man. And Jesus says, oh, guys, I'm telling you the stories because they're the stories of the kingdom and your kingdom people. You should be getting the story. So I'll help you out on this particular occasion. The parable is this. The seed is the word of God. It's the message about Jesus. It's the message about the kingdom of God invading the world. It's basically about the gospel. That's the language we use to talk about it. So when the farmer's sowing the seed, it's a person proclaiming the gospel to people, and it lands on different hearts. The ones along the path are those who have heard, and then when the devil comes and takes the word away from their hearts so that they may not believe and be saved. Oh, yeah, I hear your gospel. I just think it's stupid. Get lost, man. The ones on the rock are those who, when they hear the word, they receive it with joy, right? The plant starts to grow. This is fantastic. But they have no root. They believe for a while. In a time of testing, they fall away. Yeah, because the hot sun comes up and it beats down on the plant and it's looking for water so that it can survive, but it can't because the roots don't go down deep enough. They just don't. In order for this plant, in other words, to yield 100-fold, one of the things it's going to have to do is find a way to get deep. My parents used to live on a little island on the just off the coast of Washington State. It's a big waterway called the Strait of Juan de Fuca that came right in their I mean, the wind would come from the Pacific Ocean down the Strait of Juan de Fuca right at their house. Well, it lived on this bluff. It overlooked the water. It was magnificent. Just near them was this forest. And if you walked into the forest, one of the first things that you would have noticed was the rows of trees, maybe two or three rows deep, that faced the wind that was always beating on them. These trees were huge. They were enormous. The ones behind them, though, weren't quite as big. Well, they get these massive windstorms, and usually the big trees stay up. But one year they had such a huge windstorm that it started to knock down some of the front trees so that the wind had access into the forest, into the inner forest itself. And the entire forest went down. I remember seeing it, and there was a neighbor of my parents there, and I came across him as I was looking at this forest. I was like, wow, that must have been quite a wind. He said, yeah, the problem is usually these big trees on the front protect everything. They're so strong because they're always facing the wind. But the ones behind them are anemic little spindly trees that don't actually need to face the wind. So when they actually do face it, they've got no way to stand. They've got no way to stand. They just aren't strong enough. They've never faced enough challenge. They've never had to fight the wind. I got to tell you, I fear that so many Christians in the church today are little tiny trees with no roots. And you will not finish the race. You will not reach the harvest unless those roots go down deep. Because I'm telling you right now, I promise you, the winds are going to blow. They always do. On everyone. And the truth of your faith is going to be proved not when you're in the harbor enjoying, you know, a charcuterie board, but out in the middle of the ocean when the winds are blowing and you're like batting down the hatches. That's the moment that the strength of the ship is proven. I have this theory. It's just my theory, okay? So if you disagree with it, then that's fine. I mean, you're wrong, but that's just my theory, right? So here's my theory. I think what's happened in the church about for the last 30 or 40 years is that you've got a number of churches that have grown up and they have adopted a particular model of ministry that's sort of like, hey, you tell us what it is that's going to get you into church and we will do that thing. So what do you want in church? And you're like, dude, Ferris wheels. We're doing it. What would get you into church? A car show. We'll do a car show. What's going to get you into church? The pastor wearing $1,000 earrings. We'll do that. What's going to get you into church? Man, I don't want to hear any of that hellfire and brimstone stuff. And don't talk about any of these big doctrines and blah, 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 blah. I don't need that. What I need is helpful, you know, day-to-day stuff that's going to help me. And so there's a whole bunch of pastors that have said, okay, we'll do that. And so their sermons basically are, hey, This winter, we're going to do a series on 5 ways for you to get along with your drunk uncle at Thanksgiving. Now, I think that's good. I want to get along with my drunk uncle at Thanksgiving. But is that the kind of thing that's actually going to grow people's roots down deep enough that when they face trials and stuff, is going to... See, the church has got really, really big. They get bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger. But what they're giving people every week is this sort of anemic sort of nonsense. And so essentially what happens is it's like you're preparing your team to face the NFL, your offensive line. You're preparing them to face the defensive front of other teams. And entire training camp, you're like, here's some cotton candy, guys, and let's just sit down and play some Sudoku. That's our training camp. Nobody here wants to lift weights or do anything. I know that. So why don't we just enjoy ourselves? I mean, you guys aren't going to come back to the training camp if I don't make it fun. So they do all the time. And then they get out there for the first day and they look like the Bears. I mean, they're awful. They just get flattened. And then the coach is going to come out and go, what's wrong with you guys? But everyone should be turning to the coach and saying, what do you mean what's wrong with them? You didn't root them. You didn't feed them. You didn't prepare them for the suffering. See, my ministry is essentially summed up in preparing you to suffer so that you can die happy in Jesus. But your roots are going to have to go down deep. So how are you going to make that happen? Well, I'll tell you, the Bible actually gives one word on how you can make your roots go deep. 2 Timothy 3, all scripture is God's very words, and it's profitable for teaching, reproof, correction, training in righteousness. These are not happy words, are they? Like, you didn't wake up this morning going, you know what my life needs this day that God has made? More reproof. Nobody wants to be reproved or corrected or things, but the scriptures do that to you. Why? Well, in order that the man of God may be complete, equipped for every good work. In other words, how are we going to get your roots to go deep so that you are equipped to face life and live in a righteous way in response to all the things that are coming? Take up and read, man. Every single church that you ever attend should have as one of their main focuses the Word of God. That you are not obligated to go to a place where they don't pick up the Bible and teach you what it says. Nor should you, because there is a day coming where the wind will blow and test how deep those roots go. Uniquely planted, deeply rooted, carefully pruned. So there's this passage in John 15. A lot of people kind of misinterpret it, so I'll show you how they do, in my opinion. Many of you have heard it before. I'm the true vine. It's a picture, word picture. I am a true vine, and my Father is the vine dresser. So Jesus is the vine, and the Father is the, this is not a word we use very much. What is it, a viticulturist, gardener, whatever. The vine, the gardener. Now the gardener in this case has got some shears or whatever, clippers in his hand. Every branch in me or attached to the vine that does not bear fruit, he, the vine dresser, takes away. And every branch that does bear fruit, he prunes that it may bear more fruit. So it doesn't matter whether or not you are dead or whether you are really alive, you're going to get snipped. You'll be cut off if you're not, there's no fruit being born, but if not, you're going to, you know, if everything's going great, you're going to be snipped back. Now, I'm going to tell you, if I were able to ask the branch, when it's being snipped back to bear more fruit, if it's really excited about the shears coming at it, it's probably not going to be like, oh yeah, I love being cut up. It's awesome. Nobody likes that. But it's necessary. It's not a sign that the gardener doesn't like you or rejects you. It's a sign that he has something better for you. Yeah? Same idea is communicated in another passage in Hebrews chapter 12, but the image is used of a father and a son. Just listen to what it says. If it's for discipline that you have to endure. See, God is treating you as sons. They're facing a lot of heartache and difficulty, and so he's treating you as sons. For what son is there whom his father does not discipline? If you're left without discipline, in which all have participated, then you're illegitimate children. And not sons. You guys know people who, kids who've not been trained. you know kids who've not been disciplined. You know them. You don't babysit them. When they call you up on the phone and say, can you come over and see little Johnny? You're like, little Johnny's the devil. So I'm not coming. Good fathers, when they see Johnny acting like a little devil, they come in and they discipline. They correct. I don't do that with your kids, by the way. I'm like, if I see your kid taking a hammer to the walls of your house, I'm like, have at it, buddy. That is a good swing. But if it's my kid, I'm like, what are you doing? There's no way. Come over here. The proof that he's my kid is my willingness to discipline him. Besides this, look, we've had earthly fathers who disciplined us and respected them. shall we not much more be subject to the Father of spirits and live? Like, God's even bigger. Like, if your Father is disciplining you and it's a good thing, well, what about God in heaven? They disciplined us, our fathers, for a short time as it seemed best to them. But he, our God in heaven, he disciplines us for our good, that we may share in his holiness. Don't you see? Aren't you glad that your Father taught you not to take the fork and shove it into the electrical outlet? I'm happy. Every day I'm thinking, I had a good dad, because I'm still alive. Well, what about God then when he comes along and he prunes? Is he being vindictive? Or is he being loving? All suffering permitted through the hands of a loving God is purposeful for his people, not vindictive toward them. All suffering. It's meant to grow something. It's meant to do something in you. See, true followers, true believers, true disciples of Jesus know that God is making them better, so they don't become bitter. Because those are kind of the two options. Either you're going to submit under the mighty hand of God, or you're going to throw that hand off and say, I don't want this anymore. And the most challenging moments of your entire life will be when you're in the midst of suffering. And that's when it'll prove the pudding, right? And the wind will come and it'll prove whether the boat's going to stand. And you'll have a choice to make in that particular moment. Do you guys remember there's a passage in scripture that has Jesus is talking about prayer. And he says, what father, if his son asks for a piece of bread, gives a stone? And what father, when his child asks for fish, gives him a serpent? Your wicked dads know how to give good gifts to their kids that aren't serpents and stones. So how then will your heavenly father treat you, who's righteous and good? Now, the idea behind the whole thing is that no matter, you can ask God for something, you pray to God for something, but whatever it is, if you're a follower of Jesus Christ, whatever it is that you get is not stone but bread. I don't care if it feels like a stone. I don't care if it smells like a stone. It's bread. Feels like a serpent. No, no, no. It's fish. It's always fish. So there you are. You're sitting there and you're praying, oh God, would you deliver me from this thing? Would you give me this job? Would you make her love me? Like, God, give me this thing. And you repeat it over and over and over and over again. And God does the opposite from what you prayed. And you and I, what are you doing? And it's in this moment right here where you're going to have to make a decision about whether or not you're going to submit under the mighty hand of God, or you're going to go the other way. Most atheists that I know have a religious background, and they got let down by God. Their mom died or some horrible thing happened, and they're like, I'm not going to serve a God that does this. So what are you going to do in the moment when you're disappointed with God? Things didn't work out like you had. So either you're going to say, he's being vindictive toward me. He's hateful and capricious and terrible. We're at war. That's either that, or you're going to say, it can't be a stone. It can't be a snake. It can't. I don't see it yet, but it's fish. True disciples of Jesus know this. They know that God carefully prunes us. Last one. True followers of Jesus are persistently fruitful. Now, I didn't finish that passage in John 15, did I? We only read the first part of it, so let me read to you the rest of it. I'm the true vine. My Father's the vine dresser. Every branch in me that does not bear fruit, he takes away. And every branch that does bear fruit, he prunes, that it may bear more fruit. Okay. Already you're clean because of the word that I've spoken to you. Abide. Guys, this word means continue. There are people who run around and say things like, you know what? You need to live the abiding life, as if the abiding life is some qualitatively better life than the normal Christian life. It's not what he's doing here. He's not saying that. What he's saying is, this word that I've spoken to you that made you clean, Continue. Persist in it. Hold on to the gospel message. Keep going with Jesus. Abide in me, and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit by itself unless it abides in the vine, it continues in the vine. Neither can you unless you continue in me. I'm the vine, you are the branches. This is a fact. The image is great. Here you are, you're a branch, vine, branch, Jesus. Of course, that's what you guys always think when I point to myself. Jesus, branch, fruit. What he's saying is that this fruit out here is a product of the focus that this branch has on this vine. Yes? So the attention of the branch is always toward the vine if the fruit's going to grow, right? Actually, if it turns its attention toward the fruit, it doesn't grow. But if it turns its attention toward the vine, the abiding, the continuing in this relationship is what grows the fruit. And this is what he's saying. Look, I'm the vine. You're the branches. Whoever continues in me and I in him, he's going to bear a lot of fruit. Apart from me, you can't do anything. If you sever this relationship, if you don't focus on it, there's going to be no fruit. If anyone doesn't continue or abide in me, he's thrown away like a branch and withers. And the branches are gathered, thrown into the fire and burned. But if you continue in me, and my words, the ones that were planted in you, my words continue in you, you can ask whatever you wish, and it will be done for you. See, by this my God, Father's glorified, that you bear much fruit, and so, what's that word? Prove to be my disciples. True disciples of Jesus are people who focus their attention on Jesus as their greatest love and allegiance in all things. They persist in this desire to have Jesus. They're willing to cast aside all the other stuff that competes for their attention, right? Remember that passage that I just read about the parable of the soils? I didn't finish it. Here's the last part of it. As for what fell among the thorns, they are those who hear, they go on their way, and they're choked by what? The cares, riches, pleasures of life, the very things that you and I want all the time, right? Riches and pleasures. I want riches and pleasures. Those are good things. But he's saying, you know, they're dangerous things because they can choke out the life of the plant. Their fruit does not mature. As for that in the good soil are those who hear the word, hold it fast in an honest and good heart, and they bear fruit with patience, with persistence. They keep going. They abide. Look, true disciples of Jesus choose to forsake all other claims to their love and fidelity. Do you know that's language from my wedding? I remember saying it to my wife. I promised to forsake all other claims to my love and fidelity. I liked it because it was kind of high and lofty and sounded neat. It was better than, oh, I just think you're great. I'm going to forsake all other claims to my love and fidelity. That means that there are going to be a lot of competing factors for my attention that are going to get in the way of my love for my wife. Some of them are good. Work, friends, all sorts of desires. Some of them are really good, but they're going to compete for my attention with my wife. And what I'm promising her is that I'm actually going to forsake all of those so that I can treasure her and her alone. Can you imagine if one week after our wedding, I said those words and I'm sitting down and I'm texting and he says, who are you texting? And I'm like, Janet. Who's Janet? None of your business. I'm planning on getting together with her a little bit later. Don't worry. I'm going to come back later. It's fine. You know, there's room in my heart for all of you. She's going to say, well, what about forsaking all the claims to my love and fidelity? See, that's the deal that you and I have. And I would, of course, she kicked me to the curb because that's what it looks like to be a genuine, persistently faithful person. That's what Jesus is calling us to. He's saying, listen, I am the greatest treasure of anything, anywhere. There is nothing better than me. Guys, there's no joy in your life that comes close to the treasure of Jesus. You should sell everything you have so you can buy that field where that treasure is. It's the only thing that will ultimately satisfy you. You should do anything for you. Don't forsake that treasure for the sake of little tiny ones. What are you doing? In order to do it, though, you're going to have to persist. You're going to have to keep going. You're going to have to say, no, listen, I'm going to check out my life and figure out where it is that things are getting in the way of my love for Jesus. You know, there was a couple who came to me one time. Let's just finish with this. There was a couple who came to me one time when I was in a church in Los Angeles. I was preaching there for a friend of mine. And this couple came up to me, and they said, hi, nice to have you here. It's great. We've been waiting for you to come for the last couple of weeks. Our pastor, Matt, told us that you're from British Columbia. And I said, yeah. He said, well, we've just received job offers in British Columbia. It's quite, a pay rise. But we have told the headhunters to wait until we could talk to you. And I'm like, what? Really? And they said, we just need to know what the state of the church is in British Columbia, because we're not going to go anywhere where our faith is not going to flourish. I've talked to lots of different people, and when they consider the next job, they're usually considering the pay, the location, the benefits, the blah, da, 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 da. Very few people I've ever met were saying, you know what? I'm not going there unless Jesus is going to help us grow there. But true followers of Jesus hold the relationship that they have with him, the relationship between the branch and the vine, they hold it as primary above all things. It's what defines them. And then one day, the Lord himself parts the clouds and returns, or they lay dying on their deathbed and they fade away, not into some nothingness, but immediately they're transported to standing before the very throne of God. And he looks down at them, these persistent, faithful people, and he says, well done. Don't you want to hear that? Look, if you have anything at all in your life, isn't it that? You should go to a church that's going to try to get you to die happy in Jesus then. I know one. At Harvest Bible Chapel, we are trying to build uniquely planted, deeply rooted, carefully pruned, and persistently fruitful followers of Christ. We would love you to come along and be the recipients of that kind of ministry and join in us as we try to build it in other people. May in the future, the memory of Harvest be just a line of disciples walking out the door and God planting them all over the world for gospel renewal. Amen. Wouldn't that be great? Let me pray for us. Father, I'm thankful for, your word and the ways that it talks so much about following you. And we don't ever probably stop and think about a lot of it. So much of it is focused on the continuing and faithfulness and these things. Lord, I pray that you would help us to forsake all other claims to our love and fidelity. And pray, Lord, that you would give us eyes to see your beauty and majesty so that that forsaking is easy. Ruin us, Father, for the things of this world that promise so much and deliver so little. And may we look forward to that one day. And may we hear, well done. We pray in Jesus' name.
When the sea is calm and all is bright, when I feel your favor flood my life, and even in the good I'll follow you, and even in the good I'll follow you. When the boat is tossed upon the waves, when I wonder if even in the storms I'll follow you, even in the storms I'll follow you. 'Cause I believe everything that you say you are. I believe and I have seen your unchanging in the hardest part. And I believe that I will follow you. And I believe that I will follow you. When I see the wicked prospering, when I feel I have no voice to sing, neither than the wants of even in the wants I'll follow you. 'Cause I believe everything that you say you are. I believe I have seen your unchanging heart in the good things and in the hardest part. 'Cause I believe in that. I believe and I will follow you. When I find myself so far from home, and you leave me somewhere I don't want to go, and even in my death I'll follow you. And even in my death I'll follow you. When I come to win this race I've run, and I receive the prize that Christ has won, I will be with you.
Hardest times, I will follow you. In the times that the Lord is, you just sense his presence and things are going great, I will follow you. And may that be our heart cry. Whether it's a storm or whether it's a season where we feel like we're on a mountaintop, that we're going to follow him because we are uniquely planted. We're deeply rooted. We're carefully pruned and persistently fruitful. As a disciple of Jesus, that's what we get to focus on this week, and that's what we get to be about as we go on mission, to let that spread so that people can know Jesus. So think about your spot in this week, and you're uniquely planted that you can let that light shine and do it with everything you have for Jesus. So as you do that, know that you leave today and you are loved.